Welcome this morning to your sanctuary. I invite you to stand, and if you turn to the last page of your bulletin, the green page, we'll begin with the song, Sing Out Earth and Skies. Blessed be the holy, the one holy and living God. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, that we may continually be given to good works. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the book of Job. Job said, "Today also my complaint is bitter. His hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to his dwelling. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, but he would give heed to me. There, an upright person could reason with him, and I should be acquitted forever by my judge. If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. God has made my heart faint. The Almighty has terrified me. If only I could vanish in darkness, and thick darkness would cover my face." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is Psalm 22, verses 1 through 15, and let us read responsibly at the asterisk. My God, why have you forsaken me?
And are so far from my cry and from the words of my distress.
Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer.
By night as well, but I find no rest.
Yet you are the Holy One,
enthroned upon the praises of Israel.
Our forefathers put their trust in you.
They trusted and you delivered them.
They cried out to you and were delivered.
They trusted in you and were not put to shame.
But as for me, I am a worm and no man,
scorned by all and despised by the people.
All who see me laugh me to scorn.
They curl their lips and wag their heads, saying,
"He trusted in the Lord. Let him deliver him.
Let him rescue him if he delights in him."
Yet you are he who took me out of the womb
and kept me safe upon my mother's breast.
I have been entrusted to you ever since I was born.
You were my God when I was still in my mother's womb.
Be not far from me, for trouble is near,
and there is none to help.
Many strong bulls encircle me.
Strong bulls of Bashan surround me.
They open wide their jaws at me,
like a ravening and a roaring lion.
I am poured out like water, and my bones are out of joint.
My heart within my breast is melting wax.
My mouth is dried out like a potsherd. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth.
And you have laid me in the dust of the grave.
The epistle is from the book of Hebrews. The word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches.
Thanks be to God. This is the Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to Jesus and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it that you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you're asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I'm baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the ten heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them. And he said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." This is the gospel of our Savior. And so it's fitting that our collect, I was really moved by our collect this morning. That could be the whole focus of our sermon. It won't be, but it could be. If you notice, it says, "We pray that your grace may always precede and follow us." I need God's grace to precede and follow me. And then it says this interesting thing, that we may continually be given to good works. It doesn't say, so we may do good things. It says that if grace goes before us, and then we have our living, and then grace follows, which just sounds so comforting to me, then our lives are given to good works, that we can't help it. We're just in the good works and the love and the grace of God. Frederick Buechner has some lovely things to say. He says, "Grace is something you can never get. It can only be given. You can't go get it. It's all around you. There's no way to earn it or deserve it or bring it about, any more than you can deserve the taste of raspberries and cream, or earn good looks, or bring about your own birth. You just can't." But then he says, "A good sleep is grace," which is what I was trying to accomplish the other night. "Most tears are grace. Good dreams are grace. The smell of rain is grace. Somebody loving you is grace. Loving someone else is grace. A crucial eccentricity of the Christian faith is the assertion that people are saved by grace. There's nothing you have to do. There's nothing you have to do. There's nothing you have to do. And then he says, the grace of God means something like, and this is my favorite part, the grace of God means something like, here's your life. You might never have been, but you are. Because the party wouldn't have been complete without you. Here is the world. Beautiful and terrible things will happen. Don't be afraid. I am with you. Nothing can ever separate us. It is for you I created the universe. I love you. I hope you found that as beautiful as I did. It's just like warm oil. It's comforting beyond comfort. So originally this was published in an article, but it's also in one of his books. So I wanted to move now to Job and the Psalms. They're kind of uncomfortable. If you notice when we were reading them, Job is bitter. Have you ever been bitter? Have you ever been resentful? I have. And I'm embarrassed to say what kinds of things have made me feel that. It's not always terrible, terrible things. Sometimes it's the littlest thing, like the fact that my dog stole the beautiful knit cap that Lisa made me last summer and wanted to make a chew toy out of it. I was bitter in that moment. I was very close to a side of myself that I would not have been proud of. But you have the reality that life is difficult. Difficult things happen. And then we have to reconcile that somehow. And I'm so grateful for the messiness of our scriptures because they describe it. They describe the resentment, the bitterness, the fear, the frustration, and they lay it out before us. So I hope you and I can say, oh, me too. I'm not alone. And so the story of Job, all of these horrible things happening to him and his family, those are the human life. And the older we get, the more we notice how difficult life can be for ourselves and for people around us. And then we have the psalm, which really kind of comes right in. It says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from the cries of my heart? I don't know if I've ever heard something so sincere. I'm thankful for those words in our scripture because that is a human question. If we're really living with our eyes and our hearts open, life will hurt us. Life will be unfair. And we will struggle with what that means about us, what that means about what we think God is. So I'm so grateful for the Job passage. I hope you'll read it again at the end of the service. You can pull those green sheets out and take them home. And for the psalm that describes the experience of feeling alone and abandoned. I think that those moments when life doesn't work and our theology does not work, that's the moments, those are the moments when we grow in faith. Because those are the moments we have to ask ourselves deep questions about, am I who I thought I was? Is God who I made God out to be? And then we do the true work of discernment in our heart about what the God is that we worship and what we are as vulnerable, fickle, and loving, and delightful humans. In my earliest years of faith, I couldn't reconcile when life went wrong, with my sense of a God that seemed to be about things going right. My earliest learnings were, if you're faithful enough, things will go right. How many of you heard that in somewhere along the way, in your, or maybe you didn't hear it, but you took it? Lots of hands going up. And then it feeds this idea that, oh my gosh, if your life is better than mine, you must be doing something better than I'm doing. And then, of course, I spiral down, because if I'm not getting it right and I'm not being faithful, then I better spin up again and get it right. And that has never worked for me. Now, I'm going to say something about my journey, and please don't take it too seriously, because the one you need to worry about is your own. This is just, I think it really matters that we share our experiences and grow together, and none of it's perfect. So I was trying to reconcile this, and I think that because I believed in the performance model of God, if I perform, then God will perform. And that matched my family of origin issues. Look the part, act the part, and it will happen. I think that that really created this sense of distance. I was never going to be close enough to this God that was asking something of me that I couldn't do. And I was looking for a God that was not so distant. And that's where these hard times in life make us wrestle. Okay, well, what's wrong in my thinking? Because God must be something more than that. And that was when I read Buber's I and Thou. Has anybody read Martin Buber, I and Thou? So it talks about the difference between I and it. And it's not just about God, it's about life, it's about each other. It's when we relate in life like we're separate units. There's a me and there's an it. And the it could be a person, the it could be God. And basically it's a functional model. You use each other versus I and thou, which means you kind of bow to one another as creatures of God, divine gifts. And we also experience God as thou. I can just feel it in the word. Thou has this, my heart opens with the word thou. It kind of squeezes with the word it. But thou is reverence. It's respect. And for me, it's also intimacy. I've learned a lot through the years through other faith traditions. It's very dear to my heart to really learn how other people experience the divine center of life. And my Buddhist friends taught me something fresh. They taught me how to stay with difficulty rather than reject it. They taught me how suffering comes from attaching. We want what we want and we grab at it. And we don't want what we don't want, so we push it away. And my Buddhist friends taught me that that creates suffering, the wanting and the resisting. But when we learn that we can trust life in all of its colors, even the color of my eye as it changes, and in deeper distress and deeper hardship, that's when it comes to life. That when we can be in the honest place of saying, yes, this is really happening, and here we are. And then we take that before God and we feel what we feel. That is the transformative moment. And so I'm so grateful to a tradition that did that well. And it helped me come back to my tradition. And I started approaching God differently because I no longer felt as though events, normal human events, meant that God was far away. I learned that there is a heartbeat at the center of life. And that's now what I call God. So when something in life happens, and I'm baffled by it, and I'm thrown off by it, or I'm grieved by it, or delighted, I ask myself, Where can I listen for the heartbeat of God? Can I listen for God in this? It's been a game changer for me. It's asked me to be vulnerable. It's asked me to embrace my vulnerability. It's asked me to be more honest about my vulnerabilities. So we have Job showing us all of the distress. And then we have the psalm, which is actually a song of why, oh, why have you forsaken me? I hope you go home with some kind of grace about your human emotions and experiences. I hope you go home feeling the grace in front of you, the grace that surrounds you, so that you can just let life happen as evidence that God is here. The Old Testament Job, it says, "Today also my complaint is bitter." It says, "His hand is heavy despite my groaning." Sometimes I translate that and say, life's hand is heavy despite my groaning. Doesn't matter how much I groan, but life's hand is heavy. We don't want to say that about God because we have this idea that God is always good and light and sweet. Life's hand is heavy. Now, can I look and can I listen for the heartbeat of God in that heaviness? That's the harder work. It's not just asking for the happy miracles that prove that we're all okay. So, let's see. I have so much I could say, and I know better than to say it all. Theological moments are when life doesn't work. The best theologians in our tradition wrote from the place of a broken life. And they met God freshly because their life wasn't working. Thanks be to God for the courage and the honesty to speak from that place. May we talk to each other about that. May we openly, and I noticed that in St. Catherine's parish, is that we do. We speak honestly to each other about how life's really going most of the time. That is such a gift. It's a gift of the Spirit. And because we listen to each other, we find a God that's bigger than we thought and that's surprising. What I think I want to do is to close with, I had more that I want to say, but I think what I'd like to do, a friend of mine, John Hermanson, he used to come once a year to St. George's, he and his partner, Chris. So Chris and Johnny, they make up a group called Story Hill. I've mentioned them before. I think you've heard him before. And they're just a beautiful music duo with voices that blend beautifully. And I got to know them through the years of coming every year to try to raise money for the building. And he sings the 22nd Psalm, his version of that. And so I'd like to close with us listening to Psalm 22 in Johnny's rendition, and then just feel the beauty and the grace in being able to be so honest, and the beauty and the grace in finding that God lives there. And so I invite you to just sit back, relax, close your eyes if you want to, and listen to this version of Psalm 22. Every life that does things we don't expect. Okay, please stand with me. Somehow when we let grace surround us and we let ourselves be honest, the praises come. And I love that the image is that God is enthroned upon the praises of our ancestors and our own praises. Beautiful. I don't understand it, but it's a gift. So let's say these words of the Creed in that light. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. I invite you to kneel or be seated or stand. So there's all the options. The idea is to be in a posture of prayer. And we'll begin with the Celtic rune, and then we'll have some time to place prayer stones with or without words. And then we'll sing the Celtic rune again.